Shalom, brothers and sisters. I'm Brother Jonas, and the title of this video is Romans Chapter 9 Breakdown. In Romans Chapter 11 Breakdown, I explain how people misunderstood Paul because they don't know the history of Israel in the Old Testament. The book of Hosea explained how northern kingdom Israel was cut out of the olive tree, and the Most High said they were no longer his people, and he was no longer their Elohim. The history is important to know because Paul was going to northern kingdom Israel in his time, who were then Gentiles, also referred to as Greek, because they had adopted the Greek ways from being Hellenized during the Greek occupation, which is talked about in the Apocrypha. Our history, Christianity, don't want you to recognize by saying it is not canonized. Our enemy, Edom, is trying to tell us what belongs in our Bible. The sad thing is, until you realize that they are the enemy, you're still in spiritual bondage, and the word can't set you free. I said over and over, you have to know the history to halfway understand Paul. Live in the Old Testament and Apocrypha, and vacation in the New Testament. Chapter 9 is powerful. Speaking of us as a nation and showing Israel and Edom as being toy soldiers or as the clay that the potter formed for his holy purposes. Now, let's begin. Romans 9, verse 1. I say the truth in Christ. I lie not. My conscience also bear me witness in the Holy Spirit, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. Something is bothering Paul. He said if he could sacrifice himself from Christ for his brethren, his kinsmen, according to the flesh, he would. Notice, he's not talking about doing it for the world, but for his fellow Israelites, his brothers, relatives, according to his bloodline. Paul is not trying to bring the heathen to Christ. That will take place during the 1,000 years. The heathen or the nations need to be patient. We'll get to you. Romans 9, verse 4. Who are Israelites, to whom pertaineth the adoption and the glory and the covenants and the giving of the law and the service of the Most High and the promises? You're going to see that it is a very good thing to be an Israelite, because there are many benefits or perks to being in the heavenly royal family. Paul tells you here in verse 4 who he's talking about. He said, who are Israelites? Now, there is something that pertaineth to the Israelites and not everybody else. What is it? The adoption. The adoption into the heavenly family. The glory. The glory that goes along with being in the heavenly family and having spiritual bodies. The covenants. All the wonderful laws and commandments that the Most High gave us to make us righteous and holy, that we may live with him. The giving of the law. He gave the law to a particular people, the Israelites. It only pertains to us, although the rest of the world have our Bible and trying to dip in our word. He only gave it to Israel, and that's in Scripture. The service of the Most High. The Levitical priests and the sons of Aaron are the only ones that were allowed to give service to the Most High. All these other people out here trying to do it are false, fake, and are an abomination. The promises. The promises were only given to the Israelites. Now, there are a lot of promises that I can't cover, but one of the promises are eternal life, the promise of being kings and princesses, the promises of eternal rest, never having to labor hard again, never getting sick, never getting old, never feeling tired. There are an abundance of promises that you can search out yourself that were promised to the Israelites and none of the other nations. Romans 9, verse 5. Whose are the fathers? And of whom, as concerning the flesh, Christ came, who is over all, the Most High, blessed forever. Amen. Paul is saying Israel belongs to the Most High. Israel is Yahweh's portion out of the nations of the world. He chose Israel. Christ came for his brethren of the flesh, Israel. And Christ is ruler of all and blessed forever. Verse 6. Not as though the word of the Most High had taken none effect, for they are not all Israel, which are of Israel. Don't think the word of the Most High has failed, because they are not all Israel, which are of Israel. Meaning, many of the Pharisees and Sadducees and some Israelites that lack faith and remain in sin. Many of the Pharisees and Sadducees were not bloodline Israelites. They were put in position by Rome. They are the seed of Abraham, but not Jacob. Verse 7. Neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Just because you are of Abraham, not all of his descendants are Israelites. In Isaac shall thy seed be called. Paul is telling you the royal family bloodline will come out of Isaac. Verse 8. That is, they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of the Most High, but the children of the promise are counted for the seed. So the children of the flesh are not the children of the Most High. The children of the promise are the chosen royal bloodline. So who are the children of the flesh and the children of the promise? Let's go to verse 9. For this is the word of promise. At this time will I come, and Sarah shall have a son. So we see where the children of the promise is going to come from. It's going to come from the son of Sarah. A promise was made in verse 9 saying Sarah shall have a son. So Sarah's son Isaac will carry the seed line. Verse 10. And not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one, even by our father Isaac, for the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the promise of the Most High, according to the election, might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. It was said unto her, the elder shall serve the younger. Now we see which of the two sons of Isaac will carry the seed line, Jacob, and not Esau, because the elder shall serve the younger. The Most High made an election, and he elected Jacob to carry the seed line. Verse 13, as it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. Where was this written? Malachi 1, verse 2. I have loved you, speaking of Israel, saith Yahawah. Yet ye say, wherein hast thou loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother, saith Yahawah? Yet I loved Jacob. And I hated Esau, and laid his mountains and his heritage waste, for the dragons of the wilderness. So we see where it is written that the Most High loved Jacob and hated Esau. It's written in Malachi. Now back to Romans 9, verse 14. What shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with the Most High? God forbid. Paul is saying, is the Most High unrighteous because he hate Esau? God forbid. No. Verse 15, for he said to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. The Most High says, no one can tell me who to love or who to hate. Verse 16. So then, it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of the Most High that showeth mercy. For the scripture saith unto Pharaoh, even for this same purpose have I raised thee up, that I might show my power in thee, and that my name might be declared throughout all the earth. The Most High says, he raised up Pharaoh just to destroy him, and Egypt to glorify himself, and to be known among the nations as a terrible Elohim. Verse 18, therefore hath he mercy on whom he will have mercy, and whom he will hardeneth. Some people the Most High will have mercy on, and others he will harden, so that his will be done for his purpose. Verse 19, thou wouldst say then unto me, why doth he yet find fault? For who hath resisted his will? Some will say, if the Most High is controlling everything, why does he find fault with people that do wrong when he hardened them? Because no one can resist his will. Verse 20, nay, but O man, who art thou that repliest against the Most High? Shall the thing formed say to him that formed it, why hast thou made me thus? So who are we to question Yahawah? Can we say, why am I made this way? Or why am I a heathen and not an Israelite? No, we can't. When I was a child, I played with plastic army men and would divide them into two armies. I would choose one to win and another to lose. Now, can those plastic army men question my decisions? This is a good example for you, a good analogy to understand the potter and the clay. Verse 21, hath not the potter power over the clay, of the same lump, to make one vessel unto honor and another unto dishonor? Yahawah, the Creator, has power over the lump of dirt, that is man, and can make one vessel unto honor to go into glory, and another unto dishonor to be destroyed to show his power. Verse 22. What if the Most High, willing to show his wrath and to make his power known, endured with much long suffering the vessels of wrath fitted to destruction? The Most High is enduring much long suffering the vessels of wrath, which is Edom, who is fitted or created to be destroyed in the last days. Verse 23. And that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he had afore prepared unto glory. And that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which is Israel, which he had prepared unto glory way back when he spoke to Abraham. Verse 24. Even us, whom he had called, not of the Jews only, but also of the Gentiles. Even us, Israel, whom he called, not of Judah or southern kingdom only, but also of the northern kingdom Gentile Israelites. Verse 25. As he said also in Osi, which is Hosea, I will call them my people, which are not my people, and her beloved, which was not my beloved. Just as the Most High said in Hosea, I will call them my people, which were not my people, and her beloved, which was not beloved. Hosea 2, verse 23. And I will sow her unto me in the earth, and I will have mercy upon her that had not obtained mercy. And I will say to them which were not my people, thou art my people, and they shall say, thou art my Elohim. Back to Romans 9:26. And it shall come to pass that in the place where it was said unto them, ye are not my people, There shall they be called the children of the living Elohim. Now let's take a look at Hosea 1:10. Yet the number of the children of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured nor numbered. And it shall come to pass that in the place where it was said unto them, ye are not my people, there it shall be said unto them, ye are the sons of the living Elohim. This is a dual prophecy that applies today. It is being said in our time, we are the children of Yahawah. I mean, you've heard it because I've told you. So it is being said in this land now of our captivity that you are the children of Yahawah. You are Israelites. Romans 9, verse 27. Isaiah also crieth concerning Israel. That's Isaiah. Though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, a remnant shall be saved. Isaiah 10, verse 22. For though thy people Israel be as the sand of the sea, yet a remnant of them shall return. The consumption decree shall overflow with righteousness. 2/3 of Israel would die for their wickedness here in the last days, and 1/3 of Israel would be martyred with a small remnant not seeing death here in the end because of their righteousness. Romans 9:28. For he will finish the work and cut it short in righteousness, because a short work will the Lord make upon the earth. Yahawah will finish the work he started with Adam and with Israel, because the Most High does not fail at what he does. Verse 29, and Isaiah said before, except the Lord of Sabaoth had left us a seed, he had been as Sodom, which is Sodom, and been made like unto Gomorrah. Without the seed, which was Yahawashi, we would have been condemned and destroyed like Sodom and Gomorrah, because our sins would not be forgiven and would consume us. Yahawashi was that promised seed that the whole world would be blessed by when the Most High spoke to Abraham. Romans 9, verse 30. What shall we say then? That the Gentiles, which followed not after righteousness, have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness which is of faith? Northern kingdom Gentiles that did not keep the law in past times have obtained righteousness which is of faith. Verse 31. But Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, hath not attained to the law of righteousness. Southern kingdom Judah, which followed after the law of righteousness, did not obtain the law of righteousness. Southern kingdom Judah wanted to hold on to the sacrificing of animals and not accept Christ. Verse 32, wherefore, because they sought it not by faith, but as it were by the works of the law, for they stumble at that stumbling stone. Speaking of southern kingdom that wanted to hold on to the laws of ceremonial animal sacrifice and not have faith and accept Christ as their sacrifice, caused them to stumble at that stumbling stone, which is Christ. And remember, Christ offended many of them. Verse 33, as it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and rock of offense, and whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. The stumbling stone and rock of offense is Yahawashi. And whosoever of Israel believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Faith or belief in the things Yahawashi said in the scriptures, and prove your faith by obeying the word of Yahawah. And the word of Yahawah is Yahawashi. Remember, live in the Old Testament and the Apocrypha and vacation in the New Testament. You must understand the history to understand Paul. Shalom.